Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Today, the Quark Group welcomes Robin Cathari, who's here to speak with us. He is from the University of Waterloo. His advisors are Andrew Childs and John Watros. And Robin will actually be joining MIT as a postdoc starting in the fall. Today, he's here to talk to us about exponential improvement and precision for simulating sparse Hamiltonians. So thank you, Robin, for coming. And I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks. Thanks for the introduction. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about Hamiltonian simulation algorithms. In particular, our algorithm that has an exponential improvement in precision. So this is joint work with Dominic Berry, Andrew Childs, Richard Cleave, and Rolando Sama. Yeah, please feel free to ask questions at any time and interrupt me if you wanna. Yeah, I don't mind getting sidetracked talking about anything you wanna talk about. Okay, so first I'm gonna just start with giving you a summary of, well, what I'm gonna talk about for the next hour, maybe. So the main result is, well, we have this new algorithm for simulating sparse Hamiltonians. That's the main result. And the way our algorithm works is we reduce the problem to another problem, which is the problem of simulating fractional queries. So if you don't know what any of these things mean, that's fine. I'm going to talk about, that's what the rest of my talk is going to be about. But this is just like a big picture overview for those of you who know what's going on. And the new thing is we have this new reduction to simulating fractional queries. And then we have a new algorithm for simulating fractional queries. And this new algorithm uses a technique that we are calling oblivious amplitude amplification. So the first part of my talk is just going to be about the Hamiltonian simulation problem. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to explain what the problem is, why we care about the problem, what's known about the problem, and what have we done about this problem. OK, so let me get into it. Are there any questions at this point? Probably not. OK, so what is the problem we care about? So consider the task of simulating physical systems. So what this means is you just have a description of a system, and I tell you what it looks like right now, and you have to predict what it's going to look like after 5 minutes, so something like that. So this is a very basic, fundamental problem in physics. I mean, you could almost say that this is what it means to understand a system. Like, if you say that you understand the laws that govern a system, then you need to be able to predict what's going to happen after some time. So an example, a classical example is I give you the description of, say, you know, n bodies under gravitational force, and I tell you where they are right now and how fast each of these bodies is moving, and you need to tell me what they're going to look like after a couple of minutes. So this is just a general example. And similarly, a quantum example would be, you know, there's n qubits. There's some Hamiltonian that governs the time evolution, and I tell you what the current state of the system is, and I ask you what's the final state after some time t. And if the Hamiltonian is time independent, we know how to solve that, like explicitly as an equation, and it's just that the final wave function is e to the minus iht times the initial wave function. So more formally, the Hamiltonian simulation problem is this general problem, but specifically for quantum systems. And the problem is you're given a Hamiltonian H, which is just a Hermitian matrix. It's a complex Hermitian matrix of size n by n. You're given a time t. And what you need to do is give me a unitary that does e to the minus iht. And we allow some error, which is going to be epsilon. That's the error parameter. Now, I'm not going to talk more about what I mean by the error, but you can just take any convenient version of this that seems reasonable to you. But for example, the unitary that you implement should be close to the actual unitary e to the minus iht under some suitable norm, for example, the diamond norm or anything you like. For example, the states output by this unitary and the ideal unitary should be close in L2 distance. It should be epsilon close in L2 distance. That's also another reasonable way of thinking about what it means for two operators to be close. OK, yeah. So are there any questions about the problem, the general setup? OK, so this is what we care about. And so why do we care about this problem, right? Like that's always a It's always a good question to ask right after someone's defined a problem. So the first thing I can say is that this was the original motivation for building quantum computers. So Feynman originally said something to this effect that, you know, we want to simulate the dynamics of a quantum system, but the best way we know how to do this right now is by a classical algorithm that takes that's very inefficient, that takes exponential time to simulate the system. So that's bad. And what that means is, well, we don't know how to get simulations of systems we care about because it's just really large, and we can't solve it in today's computers. And as a result of this, a good fraction of today's like computing power is actually devoted to solving these problems that arise in practice. And people in like a diverse number of fields like quantum chemistry and material science, et cetera, they care about understanding small quantum systems, and they're not able to do this to the accuracy or maybe to the number of particles that they would like just because they're being limited by computational power. So if we had efficient quantum algorithms for this, and if we had a quantum computer, then, well, these two together would give you a lot of, well, these guys would be really happy. So we don't really have a quantum computer, but it's good to get working on the algorithms and get one that's as efficient as possible. So that's the usual motivation. That's the main motivation for studying this problem. But there's also another motivation that's interesting to me as someone who works in quantum algorithms, which is you can use this as a subroutine. Like, I mean, every time you solve a problem, you can now reduce to this problem. Like, that's just a general fact about solving problems. But specifically, Hamiltonian simulation turns out to be a pretty useful subroutine. So for example, you can use it to implement continuous time quantum walks, and it's done in this paper where they show this exponential separation between classical and quantum query complexity using a glued trees graph, and you need to traverse a tree. And another example, or another set of examples, comes from using Hamiltonian simulation this last paper that's cited there is HHL09, is this paper for solving linear systems of equations that uses Hamiltonian simulation as a subroutine. The first paper in the last line is by Fari, Goldstone, and Gutman, and that's to solve this query problem called the NAND tree problem. You need to compute the NAND of a bunch of a function that's recursively defined in terms of some Boolean variables, and that's also solved by doing a continuous time quantum walk, which is essentially a Hamiltonian simulation problem. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that Hamiltonian simulation is also useful as a subroutine for designing quantum algorithms. So now what I'm going to talk about is, I've said a couple of times that there's no known efficient classical algorithms for Hamiltonian simulation, but we have quantum algorithms that are good. So it's a good question to ask, what does efficient mean? Like, this has to be made precise at some point. Like, what is efficient? Like, of course there are classical algorithms to solve the problem if you don't require efficiency. Like, there's always classical algorithms to solve everything that quantum computers can solve if you don't insist on efficiency. The advantage is in, like, in how much time and space and whatever resources are needed. So as a computer scientist, the first phrase is kind of obvious. You know, efficient is polynomial time. That's always the answer to what is efficient. But polynomial in what? There's a bunch of parameters in this problem, so it's not completely straightforward what you might mean by polynomial time. So here I'm going to say that polynomial time is polynomial in the size of the system. So for example, if the Hamiltonian is an n by n matrix, the number of qubits it acts on is log n. So you want it to be polynomial in log n, not polynomial in n. It's fairly straightforward to do Hamiltonian simulation if you don't mind a running time that's polynomial in n, because it's just an n by n matrix. You need to exponentiate it, and that's easy. You just diagonalize it, exponentiate it. So the challenge is to do this in poly log n. And then you need some scaling that depends on how long you want to evolve for. Because of course, if you want to predict the state of a system after a long time, then you should be allowed to have more time. That just makes sense. So some dependence on t would be fine. And then there's this odd dependence on the norm of the Hamiltonian. And like at first sight, it's like, why is this weird quantity entering the system? But the reason for that is that time is not uniquely defined by itself. So the thing is that you want to simulate this unitary, which is e to the minus I h t. So h and t appear as a product. So you can always scale down the Hamiltonian by a factor of two and scale up the time by a factor of two. Or maybe do it the other way around. This would allow you to cheat if you just had some dependence on t. So somehow it should go like the product of the two of these things. So you can take any norm of the Hamiltonian you like, but there has to be some way of normalizing the Hamiltonian, so you don't just put all the time into the Hamiltonian, then just evolve a very large normed Hamiltonian for unit time, because that wouldn't make sense. And the last parameter that I'm not going to say too much about now is how should it scale with epsilon. So epsilon is this accuracy threshold that I want to be within epsilon of the right map. And it's not completely clear a priori how things should scale with epsilon, and maybe a polynomial in 1 over epsilon would be fine, but if you can get poly log 1 over epsilon, that would be even better. And what we do in this work is we improve the scaling with epsilon, and we actually get it down to poly log 1 over epsilon, as compared to previous simulations that went like a polynomial in 1 over epsilon. Okay, so yeah.
Didn't the previous work of Barry Cleave with Soma also get it down to poly log 1 over epsilon?
Yes. So, so our work is now merged with their work. So, in a sense, we're thinking of previous work as stuff before that. Yeah. So we decided to merge our papers. So that paper is now to be considered subsumed by our paper. So, yeah. Right. Any other questions? Okay. Yeah. So another interesting question, or like one of the things you might think about first is, can you simulate all Hamiltonians efficiently? And if you think about this for a while, this is not possible even on a quantum computer. And maybe it's not obvious to see why on a quantum computer, but the analogous classical question would be, can you compute all functions with polynomial-sized circuits? And well, that's just not possible. Like, there's just too many functions and too few circuits. Like, you can just, do a simple counting argument to convince yourself that you cannot. All functions don't have polynomial-sized circuits, and it's the same thing quantumly. Like, you cannot simulate all Hamiltonians in polynomial time. That's just not possible. So, all you can hope for is to be able to simulate some restricted classes of Hamiltonians. And so, what Hamiltonians should we think about? And I guess, going back to our motivation, one good class to study would be the classes that actually arise in practice. Like that makes sense. And Hamiltonians that arise in practice are often local Hamiltonians. Like that's a widely studied class of Hamiltonians that arise in practical applications. But more generally, you can think of a class of Hamiltonians called sparse Hamiltonians that I'll define on the next slide, which is a generalization of local Hamiltonians and effectively captures almost all the Hamiltonians that you would want to simulate on a quantum computer, especially from practical applications. I'm not aware of any application that needs you to go beyond this model of simulating Hamiltonians. And lastly, I'd just like to mention that this problem of simulating local Hamiltonians, or even sparse Hamiltonians, is BQP hard. And what this means is that it's the hardest problem that can be solved by a quantum computer. So, in other words, if a classical computer could solve the Hamiltonian simulation problem, then every problem that can be solved by a quantum computer can also be solved by a classical computer. So there's, like, this is the hardest problem, and if you can solve this, then quantum computers don't do anything for you at all. And in other words, there would be classical algorithms for, like, factoring, et cetera. So this also makes this problem interesting, I guess. It's somehow truly representative of the class of problems that can be solved on a quantum computer.
When you say BQPR, is it under classical reductions or quantum reductions? Give you an instance of the problem.
Right, yeah, so it's classical reductions, but I would have to define a decision version of this problem more specifically. I mean, right now I've just defined it as a problem of producing the final state. That's, of course, not a problem that a classical computer could ever solve because it cannot produce a quantum superposition for you. But you would have to define an appropriate decision version of this, and that could be something like, I give you the initial state, the Hamiltonian, and what you need to do is for the final state, maybe sample from the final state's property distribution. But even a simpler one, like just tell me, say you're promised that the first qubit has a very high probability of answering 1 or 0, and you just need to decide which one of those two. And then that's a decision problem now. And this decision problem you can classically reduce to, you can show that if this decision problem has a classical algorithm, then all quantum algorithms can be done classically. So that's the.
Another problem that's not BQP hard, say Jones polynomial, right. could convert it into an instance of sparse Hamiltonian.
Yes.
Via
yes.
a classical algorithm, you would take that instance, compute a local Hamiltonian or sparse Hamiltonian,
right.
then
right.
you would run.
Yes, yes, you can do that. Yeah. In fact, it's a local Hamiltonian, and I think it's a four local Hamiltonian. That's the cleanest, easiest construction I know. And that reduction will be fully classical. So I'll take your instance of Jones polynomial, and I'll spit out a local Hamiltonian, which I'll, you know, write down on a piece of paper for you. So yeah, that's the sense in which it's a hard and it's a complete problem, I guess, in that sense. Yeah. Are there any other questions about this? No. Okay. Yeah.
Finding a ground state, is that also PQP hard?
No. So finding a ground state is a really hard problem. So that's funny you asked that question. So I'm going to get to that in two slides. So that's a question that's often confused with Hamiltonian simulation, but they're actually completely different problems. So I'll get to that in two slides. But yeah, before I get to that, let me just tell you what local and sparse Hamiltonians are more formally, and then talk about how is the input to the problem specified. So what is the input to the problem first? It's a Hamiltonian on n. Of like a n by n matrix, a time and epsilon. So let's start with local Hamiltonians. So this is something that a lot of people are usually familiar with. So a local Hamiltonian is just a Hamiltonian that's a sum of terms that each acts non-trivially only on a constant number of qubits. So for example, a three local Hamiltonian is a Hamiltonian that's a sum of terms, and each term just involves three qubits out of the log n total qubits that you have. And so how would you specify a local Hamiltonian to me? You just write it down on a piece of paper for me, right? So there's only each term only acts on, say, three qubits. So for each triplet of qubits, you can just tell me what the local Hamiltonian is. That's a polynomial size description. It's not too long. So that's just the input. So the local Hamiltonian problem is pretty easy to deal with. The input representation problem comes about when you talk about sparse Hamiltonians. So what's a sparse Hamiltonian? So recall that the Hamiltonian is an n by n matrix. So in principle, it could have n squared non-zero entries. And in each row or column, it could have up to n non-zero entries. So we say a Hamiltonian is sparse if it has only polylog n non-zero entries. And by polylog n, I mean just some polynomial in log n, like say log n squared or log n to the fourth or something. So this is drastically fewer non-zero entries than is potentially possible. So it's really sparse. It's like it's almost all zero, except a couple of entries. And even though it's sparse in this sense, the matrix itself can still have exponentially many non-zero entries. Like for example, the identity matrix is a very, very sparse matrix, right? It has only one non-zero entry per row or column. But still, if you had to describe the identity matrix like by listing everything out, there's exponentially many ones, because the matrix is of size n by n. So if you want me to simulate a sparse Hamiltonian for you, you cannot just write this down on a piece of paper for me, because it's going to take me exponential time to read this piece of paper, and then you cannot expect me to run in polynomial time. Like that just wouldn't make any sense. So you need to have some kind of succinct description of this Hamiltonian. And what often happens in practice, or in all the cases of sparse Hamiltonian simulation I know, is that you have the following kind of succinct description, which is, if I tell you the row number and I ask you for a particular non-zero index, you can compute this pretty efficiently. So I can tell you, hey, what's the fifth non-zero entry of the eighth row? And you have some efficient algorithm that spits this out. So for example, if the Hamiltonian is local, then you can come up with a polynomial time algorithm that does this kind of thing. So this is what we call, it's an efficiently row computable Hamiltonian, which means you can just compute non-zero entries in any row efficiently. And what we do in this sparse Hamiltonian simulation model is we assume we've been given a black box that just does this for you. And we think of complexity in terms of the number of queries you need to make to this black box. And we'll also count the total number of gates that you'll need, like the other 1 and 2 qubit gates that you need. But in terms of the Hamiltonian, we'll just count the number of queries made to this black box, because we don't know how expensive this black box is to actually implement, and that depends on the problem at hand. So are there any questions about local Hamiltonians, sparse Hamiltonians, or how they're represented? We're good? Okay, let me summarize what we know about current Hamiltonian simulation algorithms. So yeah, as I said, we're going to measure the complexity of the problem in terms of the number of queries made to this black box that we assumed on the last slide. And the relevant parameters are n, the size of the Hamiltonian, the time that you're evolving for, the error parameter, and d is going to stand for the number of maximum number of non-zero entries in any row. This is the thing that we assume to be poly log n. So at the end, you'll get a polynomial time algorithm. So the first algorithm of this kind was by Lloyd in 96. And this only worked for local Hamiltonians. And it gave that kind of scaling. So it's polynomial in the d and log n. And I think it's quadratic in these other parameters. This was later improved by Aharonov and Tashma, who extended it to sparse Hamiltonians. And they introduced the sparse Hamiltonian problem for the first time. And they got better dependence on some of these parameters, and well, they extended to a larger class of Hamiltonians. And then after that, there's been a bunch of improvements. So in the next paper by Berry, Ahokas, Cleave, and Sanders, they really get down the dependence on some of the parameters. So for example, this previous one, it was just I've just said poly log n, and it was some polynomial in log n. But here they brought it down to log star n, which is a really, really slow-growing function of n. And so yeah, maybe I won't define it, but like for any reasonable n that you would put in, like for example, the number of particles in this universe, log star of n is 6. So it's not something you should worry about much. You can almost think of that as a constant for any real application. So the thing I wanted you to notice is that the dependence on the error parameters. It goes like 1 over epsilon to the delta for any delta greater than 0. So for example, like, think of delta as 0.01 or something. So it goes, the dependence on 1 over epsilon is pretty good. Like it's a very small polynomial in 1 over epsilon, but it's still polynomial dependence. And that's the same thing in the next result, which just improved the dependence on d, the sparsity parameter, but essentially left other things unchanged. And the last one on this slide is a completely different approach, and it's not related to the previous approaches. And that gets a better dependence on the degree, but at the cost of a worse dependence on epsilon. Now it goes like the square root of epsilon, square root of 1 over epsilon. So all of these algorithms had polynomial dependence on epsilon, and this was a open question for quite a while. Is this necessary? Like, do we need polynomial dependence on 1 over epsilon, or can we get it down to poly log 1 over epsilon? And that's essentially one of the main things that we're talking about right now, which is that our algorithm finally achieves poly log 1 over epsilon dependence. And in fact, it achieves this weird function, which is if you just isolate the dependence on epsilon, we get this dependence, which is log of 1 over epsilon divided by log log 1 over epsilon, which yeah, kind of seems like a strange function out of nowhere. But in fact, it's optimal. We also prove a matching lower bound, showing that log over log log is the right dependence, even though this function looks kind of like, you know, out of nowhere. But it's really the right dependence with respect to epsilon. So yeah. All right, yeah. Any questions about this? No, OK. So that's all I'm going to say about Hamiltonian simulation, except I'm going to answer Martin's question with a full-blown slide. Yeah. So what is the difference between the simulation problem and the problem of finding ground states? So this is something that people often ask about, and sometimes people think that the simulation problem is the same as the problem of finding ground states. So they're extremely different problems morally. So if you take a very coarse view of life, where quantum and classical and all of this stuff is the same, like we don't even differentiate between quantum computers and classical computers. They're just computers that run in polynomial time. The simulation problem is an easy problem in principle. It's just, mimic the behavior of this other system. And if you have enough resources, then you can do it. Maybe you have a little bit of a slowdown, but in principle, you can do it. Whereas the finding a ground state kind of problem, this is a bit like, among all possible configurations that the system could have started with, what is the best one that maximizes something? Like it's like an optimization problem. So for example, if you're just given a Boolean circuit, and I give you an input, and I ask you, what's the output? So you want to mimic the behavior of this Boolean circuit. That's really easy. You just follow all the gates. You compute whatever the outputs are supposed to be. It's a small circuit. You can do it. But if I ask you, is there any input to this Boolean circuit that outputs 1? Like that's the satisfiability problem. Like that's a well-known NP-complete problem. That's really hard. So similarly, in quantum, it's like, I give you a quantum circuit, and I give you an input, and I ask you, can you do this? If you have a quantum computer, yeah, sure, just follow the circuit. It's almost trivial. On the other hand, finding the ground state is almost like finding something like the maximum acceptance probability over all inputs, or finding like which is the input that maximizes the acceptance probability. So this is a really hard problem. So that's kind of what I'm trying to get across in this slide, that a simulation problem is generally easy if you have enough resources if you have resources similar to the kind of system that you're trying to simulate. So if you're trying to simulate a classical system and if you have classical resources, it's kind of an easy problem. Whereas ground state kind of problems are always really hard, and in general, they're NP hard if your problem is a classical problem. It could be QMA hard if it's something about a circuit. And yeah, whatever it is, it's going to be quite hard. Okay. Does that answer your question about?
The definitions seem to me very, they have a very different flavor, those two classes. Like when you say BQP hardness versus QMA hardness, one is like a semantic class in classical complexity, right? How do you even know that a problem is in BQP? If I write down a definition of a language, do you even know it's in BQP, right? And you reason about probability of acceptance and so on.
That's right.
That's different for QMA, right?
QMA is also a semantic class.
I thought it's a syntactic.
No, there's no syntactic definition of QMA because. If I give you a QMA machine, how do you know that it has this property that has more than 2/3 accepting probability or less than 1/3? It's the same with classical MA. Like even MA has the same problem. Even BPP has a problem.
Right.
These are all semantic classes.
NP would be an example of.
So NP is a syntactic class. Yeah. So if you wanted to be extremely technical, then I should be saying promise BQP and promise QMA and things like that, because they're all. It's hardness for the promise versions of these classes where you've assumed this kind of behavior. But yeah, most people don't care about that level of technicality, so I don't get into that. But like morally, it's hard, and it's QMA hard versus, in that sense, it's NP or BQP. Okay, yeah. Any other questions about this or about Hamiltonian simulation or anything I've talked about? So that was what I would say is the intro part, when I'm trying to convince you that the problem's interesting and what I'm thinking about is interesting. On why I care about the problem. Looks good? Okay. So this is a summary of the first part of my talk. I talked about Hamiltonian simulation, and I told you that I have this algorithm that scales like this, where tau is t squared times the norm of the Hamiltonian times t. And it has this kind of nice dependence on error. I haven't told you how this algorithm comes about. I've just stated the result. In the second half of my talk, I'm going to try to explain to you how the algorithm comes about. And to do that, I'm going to start with something called the fractional query model. So if you've never heard of it, that's fine. You probably shouldn't have heard of it. It's just a really exotic model to study. So I'm going to describe what this model is, what we know about it, what we did, and try to prove what we've done. And when I talk about this right now, it's going to be completely unrelated to Hamiltonian simulation. So just put that out of your mind for the next 20 minutes or so. And finally, in the last 10 minutes or so, I'm going to connect up these problems and show you how we reduced Hamiltonian simulation to this fractional query model. Okay, so let's talk about quantum query complexity. So this is one of my favorite topics. So quantum query complexity is just this model where you have some input and you need to compute some function of this. Classically, what you have is you have oracle access to this input in the sense that so think of the input as an n-bit string. And you have oracle access in the sense that you ask the oracle, hey, what's the fifth bit of this string? And the oracle replies, it's a 0 or it's a 1. And quantumly, it's the same thing, but now you're allowed to do this in superposition. That's where a lot of the power of quantum computing comes from. And so the standard way to represent this oracle is like this. You give the oracle two indices, I and b. I is a number between 1 and n, and b is just a bit. And what's going to happen is it's going to put a phase up front on your state. And the phase is going to be plus or minus 1 based on the bit xi that you're trying to learn. And so that's the standard query complexity model. And the measure of complexity is how many queries you make to this black box, so how many questions you ask the black box. So for example, this is a circuit that depicts a two-query algorithm. So there's some unitary that's independent of the input. Then you make a query. You do another unitary, you make a query, so that's a two-query algorithm. Now suppose I gave you the ability to make half a query. It doesn't really make sense, because you're asking for a bit. What does it mean to give me half a bit? So it doesn't make any sense classically, but quantumly it does make sense, because what's happening is if the bit was 1, I was going to put a phase of minus 1. If the bit was 0, I was going to put a phase of plus 1, or basically not do anything. But instead of putting a phase of minus 1, I can put a phase of I, And that's like doing half a query, because if you do this two times, then you get a phase of minus one. So two half queries can simulate a one query, so that justifies calling it a half query. And so now think of this model where you're allowed to make half queries, and if you have a circuit of this kind where you've used four half queries, I'm still going to charge you two queries for it. I'm going to say that your circuit made two queries. And then maybe generalize it to a quarter query, and like you can make eight quarter queries, and I'm still going to count that as two queries, and so on. You're allowed to make arbitrary fractional queries, and I'm only going to count the total full queries.
How do you get away with doing that?
Sorry?
How do you get away with counting? I went to the Oracle four times. Whether or not I got half a bit each time or I got a full bit, how does that affect the amount of work?
Exactly. So I mean, it seems like this is just a crazy thing to do, right? Like I'm charging you less than
I just think it's four and eight, so why am I wrong?
Right. So I'm going to convince you later that it's actually this is right. But let's define this model, which seems like a right, so it means that instead of being given this gate that has a minus one up here, like replace this definition with, instead of minus one, you put the correct square root of minus one. So for half a query, you put I. For a quarter of a query, you put like the fourth root of minus one. So it, in general, it'd be e to the I pi, or e to the 2i pi divided by the fraction. So if you want to make an alpha fractional query, it's e to the 2 pi I alpha. That's the gate you've been given. So. Right. So the only trivial observation you can make about that gate is that if you use that gate the correct number of times, like if you use this gate four times, you get back the usual thing. So if I define this model where I use this kind of counting, as opposed to just counting the total number of times I call the oracle, but this kind of count, it's at least as powerful as the usual model. But it seems like it's way more powerful, because this model like gets to do so much more. It's almost like it's cheating. But I guess the punchline is that, no, it's not more powerful. And this was shown by let's see if I can remember all the authors. Cleve, Gardisman, Mosca, Sommer, and Young Mallow. Right. And so this was I think a stock paper from 2009 where they showed that if you have a fractional query algorithm, so an algorithm that crazy model that makes capital T queries counted in the way I described, it can be simulated in the regular model, which has just normal queries, and it just uses a little more number of gates. So if you think of simulating it to some constant precision, that uses something like T log T gates, which is very close to T. But the model seemed like it was way more powerful. It seemed like it was allowed to cheat and do great things. But it turned out that you can simulate it essentially with just a log factor loss. So that's really surprising, because this model, you wouldn't have thought that. But that's true. And so what we do is we improve upon this result by getting a better dependence on epsilon. And this connects up with the epsilon and the Hamiltonian simulation, which we're trying to improve, which is the main focus of that work, I guess. So that's why epsilon is a parameter we're trying to reduce the dependence on. So what we do is we improve this scaling from this expression to this expression. The difference is only in the epsilon and the denominator. OK. So yeah, OK, any questions about the fractional query model or what we did? Because it's kind of a strange model to wrap your head around.
Basically, go read the paper to understand why they're equivalent in cost.
No, I'm going to explain that to you. But maybe not in great detail, but I'm going to kind of explain that to you. Or hopefully I can at least convey the intuition for why that's happening. So OK, so I'm going to prove, well, our stronger result. So this is the number of queries I claim that you need to simulate a fractional query algorithm that makes only T queries. So the first thing to observe, so that's broken down in two steps, the first thing to observe is, well, how many queries do you need to simulate a one query algorithm? So I have a fractional query algorithm that makes one query in total, but that it could be using a whole bunch of fractional queries. And I'm going to convince you that it can actually be simulated using only one log of 1 over epsilon by log 1 over epsilon queries. So that's the special case when t equals 1. But this special case implies the general case, because you can split up a t query algorithm into t one query algorithms, and you choose the error bounds to be small enough in each little part so that when you combine them, the error is still small enough. And it's just the usual thing, and you'll get the right expression. So all I need to do is convince you that a single query fractional query algorithm can be converted to a normal algorithm in the usual model, and it only makes this number of queries to achieve error epsilon. And so if I can prove this point number two, then I've proved the result I claimed. Okay, so this is a summary so far. What's happened is we talked about Hamiltonian simulation a while ago, but now put that out of your mind. I introduced the fractional query model. I claimed that this can be simulated with T queries. You can simulate a T query algorithm with this number of queries. Then I talked about the special case when t equals 1, and I showed, well, I argued that they're equivalent. So that part is easy. It's the sketch of a proof I gave on the last slide. So now what I need to do is I need to convince you that this box is true. So that box is true, assuming this box is true. OK, so to prove this is true, I'm going to first prove something even weaker. So it's going to be a chain of reductions. So what's even weaker than this is, so we're trying to simulate a one-query algorithm. And we don't know how to simulate this directly, but what we know how to do is simulate it probabilistically. Well, I like to call it probabilistically, but you can also think of it non-deterministically. So we have a circuit that when it succeeds, it does the one-query algorithm. When it fails, it does something bad, but we know how to fix that. So it's in the spirit of these repeat until success circuits. So what do I mean precisely? So what I mean is, let's start with a one-query fractional query algorithm. So what does that mean? It's some unitary V which can be written like this, where there's a whole bunch of fractional queries. Like there's m fractional queries, each of which are a mth fraction of a query. And I've taken all the fractions to be equal in this example, but it also works if they're different. And you're allowed to do arbitrary unitaries in the between these queries. And V is some unitary that's now that we say it can be implemented in the fractional query model with cost 1. And what we want to do is we want to implement V in the usual model with only log 1 over epsilon by log 1 over epsilon queries. So this weaker thing of not being able to actually do V, but being able to probabilistically implement V or non-deterministically implement V is this thing that I talk about here. So think of this map U as a map that kind of implements V, or it implements V in coherent superposition with something else that you don't care about. So what it does is it takes 0 times ketch psi and it maps it to V ketch psi with the first qubit telling you that, well, this has worked with some probability p. And with probability 1 minus p, it does something else. Maybe we don't know what it does. It's important that there's a qubit that tells you that you've succeeded. Otherwise, you don't know when you've succeeded. So think of p as a constant. So what these guys showed is that there is really an algorithm that only takes log 1 over epsilon by log 1 over epsilon queries and does this task for you. So this is not the task we set out to do, but it's kind of almost the task. And it's for some constant p. Think of p as 0.1 or something if you want to think of a constant. And given such a procedure as a subroutine, what we want to do is we want to just get v psi out of it. So we want to get a circuit that just implements v for you instead of this this thing that's non-deterministically implementing v. So the most straightforward thing you would do with a circuit that implement something with a certain probability is, well, you apply u and you measure the first qubit. You see if you got 0. If you get 0, then you're good. You have v psi. If you don't have 0, then you've got this state ket phi, which I haven't explained what it is. But you can work out the details, and there's some description of ket phi, which shows you that you haven't actually lost ket psi. Then you reverse this, get back ket psi, and try to do it again. The problem is the reverse procedure also is probabilistic, because you need to run the same map again. So then you have this this kind of a really complicated recursion relation to analyze, where with some probability you fail, and then the correction procedure also fails with a certain probability, and this is really hard to analyze, and you need a large number of gates to do this. So this is how they were doing it before in the previous result, and that's why they kind of had this bad dependence on epsilon, because to be more precise, you need to bound the total number of branches that are going to fail, and you want the total whatever possibility of failing to be really, really small. So we get around this problem and show that if you're given a map that does this, we can just implement v psi for you deterministically. Like no probabilities, no non-deterministic, whatever.
How does p depend on the given algorithm?
So p is just a constant. I just didn't write it down, but it's something fixed. Like think of it as just as 0.1. It's independent of the algorithm. I know it, yeah. Like, I would know it, but it's some crazy something.
Can it be computed in principle from the given
description? Yes. It's something like, there's some sines and cosines of the fractions involved. So if all the fractional queries are 1 over m, it's something like a sine of 1 over m plus 1, the inverse of this, something. But they're all basic trigonometric operations. You can compute it in principle just by looking at the v that you present to me.
But it depends depends on the U's and the queries?
It doesn't depend on U's. It only depends on the fractions that you use here. So if all of them are 1 over m, then I can just compute the number for you. And it's something simple. But if all of them are different, then it's some number that depends on what each of those things are. But it's a simple calculation. Like classically, if you just need to tell me the fractions in the exponent, and I can tell you what p is. OK, so let me summarize what we know till now. So right, we were at this stage where this was the result I was trying to prove. I showed you it's equivalent to this simpler result. And then I introduced this fractional query model where we're trying to probabilistically simulate this in the sense of the previous slide, where with probability p, it does the right thing. With probability 1 minus p, it does something wrong. And now what I want to show you is that if you have a way of doing this, then you can do that efficiently, and in fact, using only a constant number of uses of this circuit. So that's going to be what we call oblivious amplitude amplification. So okay, so what's the problem? The problem is you have this unitary u, which takes u psi and it maps it to p time, like with probability p, it maps it to the thing you want, to probability 1 minus p, something you don't want. So one obvious idea is, hey, let's use amplitude amplification, because that's something that's a standard technique to improve or increase the probability on some good subspace and decrease the probability on some bad subspace. So what does amplitude amplification do? What you would need to do is you would need to reflect about the good subspace, which in this case is the subspace that has 0 in the first register. So that's easy to do. Well, it's just just the Z gate on the first qubit. So that's fine. But you also need to reflect about the starting state. So the amplitude amplification is a technique that takes two reflections and does them over and over again. But the other reflection is a reflection about the starting state, and that's u times this thing over here. But catch psi is a state that you don't know. Like this is some state. This is the input state to your algorithm. You know, you're trying to simulate the behavior of a unitary on an unknown input state. You don't know catch psi, so you don't have the ability to reflect about it. Like you don't even know what it is. Like if you measured it or did anything, you would destroy the state. So you can't just use amplitude amplification. So that's the problem. So what we introduce is this thing we call oblivious amplitude amplification, and it's oblivious in the sense that you don't need to know the input state. So it works when the input state is unknown, so you're oblivious to the input state. And what we show is that given such a circuit, you can indeed do exactly what amplitude amplification would do, but we don't use the same two reflections, of course, because the second reflection is something we don't know how to implement. So we use a different reflection. But what we show is that the way the algorithm proceeds is that it does exactly what amplitude amplification would have done had you had the correct reflection to do. So, and this uses ideas from Marriott Waters, which is they introduced a couple of nice techniques in that paper for dealing with these kinds of things. And just as in standard amplitude amplification, if you know what p is, the success probability, then you can boost amplitude amplification to get you the right state with probability 1. So this is like in Grover's algorithm, if you know there's exactly one marked item, you can find it with certainty. Like it's not probabilistic anymore. And that's a general feature of amplitude amplification, that if you know the probability, then you can exactly get the right answer. So that's what's happening here. We know what p is, as Martin asked. Like, I can compute what p is from the description of the circuit. And then I have this technique, oblivious amplitude amplification, that exactly lets me, since I know p, I can do amplitude amplification. And I can exactly get probability 1 here. So what I get at the end of the day is just phi psi, no error. And I have an exact statement of the theorem for, I don't know if someone is really interested in the technical details of what this theorem states. What's the lemma now? So essentially it says that, you know, u and v are unitary matrices that have this property, that, you know, u acting on 0 psi produces v psi with some probability sine theta or amplitude sine theta and cos theta of doing the wrong thing. And just as an amplitude amplification, there's some, you can define some unitary s, which when you apply t times to this, it increases the probability of being here by 2t. So, you know, you start at the angle theta, you do it once, you get 3 theta, then you do it again, you get 5 theta, and so on. So this is exactly the statement of amplitude amplification. It's just that we're using a different operator here. And it's not the two reflections that you would have had in amplitude amplification. So this needs to be proved, that using these reflections instead of the ones that you were supposed to use actually works. and still produces the same thing. So this is the heart of the technical content for this lemma. But if you just want to use it like a black box, then it's just like amplitude amplification. You don't need to worry about the details. So right, so this is
the practical cost of it. No, I mean I understand that asymptotically it's just the same as the regular amplitude, right?
Yes.
But it's not about the constants.
No, it's exactly the same. So the states, even the states that amplitude amplification will go through, this goes through exactly the same set of states. So it's really mimicking it. And effectively what's happening is you were supposed to use some reflection A, but we're using reflection B. And what we show is that reflection A and B are the same in the subspace in which you're operating. So from the perspective of the algorithm, it doesn't know which one you used. Like, did you use the one you were supposed to, or did you use our reflection that's kind of the wrong one to use? But it's the same in the subspace that the algorithm works. So the algorithm doesn't know the difference. So that's where we're getting this power from.
So in fact, your technique is a sweeping generalization of regular.
Well, if you know P as a constant, the whole point is you know P, that's why this works.
Actually, you don't need to know
P. You don't need to know P.
You just need to know P to make it deterministic.
Excuse me. So for the determinist, yes.
Right,
you don't need to know P, but if you do know P, then it's fully deterministic.
Right. So that's the same even in amplitude amplification. If you know P, you can get it. So, I mean, I guess it's a generalization in the sense that we can apply it when you don't know the input state, but it assumes this very specific form for the thing that you're trying to amplitude amplify. Like, amplitude amplification works even in other cases where it's not like this. Or for example, like one example could be that this probability P depends on psi. Like, it's different for every psi.
Oh, okay.
Like, that's a different thing, and then this technique doesn't do anything about that. But amplitude amplification would still let you amplify that.
So not really.
It's
an orthogonal technique that turns out to be sufficient for your purposes.
Yes. The set of things you could apply amplitude amplification on is large. There's a smaller set of things in which our problem lies, and for that smaller set of things, we have a generalization. So it doesn't generalize amplitude amplification, but if you happen to be in this class of things, then that's great for you. And this technique has already found applications. So I think so. Krista and Adam used it in one of their recent papers to boost the success probability of some circuit. So that's nice. Right. So let me summarize again what we have so far. So I said that let's assume that you have this ability to probabilistically implement this unitary or non-deterministically, and then I introduced this technique called oblivious amplitude amplification that allows you, given a way to do this, you just use this guy a constant number of times and get the thing you want. And then I convinced you that these two are equivalent. So if you have this ability, then you can get all the way up there. So, right. So now all I need to do is convince you that this makes sense. And then you would be convinced that makes sense. I still need to relate this to Hamiltonian simulation, but this is where we are right now. OK, yeah. Any questions about this? OK, this is making sense so far. OK, so now let me try to explain how do we do this probabilistic or non-deterministic simulation of a one-query algorithm. So this is really the heart of so you might have this intuition that this model is really strong, but you can simulate it with just like a constant number of queries for constant precision. So how is that? So all the magic's happening in this step. So let me explain how this step goes. So again, let's start with the one-query algorithm. It looks like this, just like before. Some m fractional queries are being made to the oracle. There's m unitaries in between. And as I claim that these guys showed that you can do this for some constant. So that's a summary of what I've been saying. OK, let me introduce this thing called the fractional query gadget. So it's a little gadget in the sense of it's a little circuit. And it's a circuit over here. And it's nice. What it does is, so it has three 1-qubit gates and one controlled Q. And it starts with 0 and catch psi. And what it does is, at the end, if you measure the first qubit, if you get a 0, then the second register is in the state q to the alpha get psi. So for example, think of if you set alpha to half, or say alpha is a quarter, then when you run this circuit, with some probability, you're going to get a 0 here. And this guy is exactly the state you wanted. This is a quarter of a query done on get psi. So right now, I haven't.
Right. So the Q is a black box query, right?
Right.
you're now assuming that the control Q is also available.
Yes.
So is it always to possible to manufacture, or is it an additional assumption?
No. Right. So the way I define Q, so I'll just write this here, is I define Q to have this like this. Given such a queue, you can always make a controlled version of it. And that's because this second register B is effectively the control. When you set B to 0, the map does nothing, because B is 0, this is 0, minus 1 to the 0 is 0. So it's the identity map. So the definition of the oracle already includes control. And this is the traditional way to define it. But if you were given a version of the oracle that does not have control, then there's no way to manufacture it. That's hard. That's probably hard, I guess. So this is a little gadget. And what it does is it uses one copy of Q. And with some probability, it does Q to the alpha times psi. So right now, this seems like it doesn't help at all. Like, firstly, it uses one full query to do a fractional query. So that didn't help us out. And it does it probabilistically. So that's pretty crappy as well. Like, it seems like you didn't get anything out of this. But the good part is this circuit outputs 0, like the outcome that you want, with probability very close to 1. And it's 1 minus big theta of alpha. And by that, I mean that the amount by which it's far away from 1 is linear in alpha. So if alpha is really, really small, like say it's 0.00001, then this is almost probability 1. So you've almost certainly succeeded when you do this map. This still doesn't seem great, because you've still used one full query to do a fractional query. It's like, well, how does that help you? But just keep this in mind, that this succeeds almost certainly. And so this is just the definition of the gates there. I mean, it's not really important, but just for completeness, if somebody wants to know what the gates are. So keep this gadget in mind. And now what we can do is we can use this gadget over and over again. So say you want to do, you have some starting state. You first want to do U0 on it. You just do it. That's just a unitary. That's free. You want to do Q to the 1 over m. So you do that using this gadget over here. Don't measure this final state. Just let it be for now. Then apply U1 on the output of this circuit. You can do that. Then take a fresh ancilla and do this gadget again on the state to enact the second gate, and so on. Like, do each of these gates one after the other on the output of the circuit. So what I mean is essentially, well, implement this circuit over here, which is you have m ancillas, one for each fractional query that you're trying to do. So you start with do u0, do this fractional query gadget. And there should have been a gate here, which I just pushed to the end, because it doesn't matter. There's no more gates happening on this line. Then you do u1. Then you do the fractional query gadget on the same state, because it's the same state that you're trying to evolve with these fractional queries. And you do this for all m, and you collect it up into this one big circuit that we are calling a segment. And what does this segment do for you? What it does is, if you measured all of these qubits, and if you got zeros for all of them, then the circuit did exactly what you wanted it to do. It did all the fractional queries right. It did all the unitaries in the middle right. Like, you're just good to go. So what's the probability of all of them being 0? So as I said before, the probability of one of them being 0 was very close to 1, and it was bounded away by some linear function in m. So it's like a coin toss, where the probability of the bad outcome is like 1 over m, and the probability of the good outcome is 1 minus 1 over m. And if you toss this m times, what's the probability that you always succeed? It's some constant. So this is a circuit that has some constant probability of succeeding. And it's some fixed constant that you can compute based on these m. So this is related to what you were asking before. And it's just it's something. Maybe it's like 0.1 or something. It's easy to compute with some tail bound, et cetera. So this is a circuit that implements the map that we wanted to implement with constant probability, and where you've succeeded when all of these qubits are 0. So that's great, right? So that's what we were heading out to do. We wanted a circuit that takes that effectively implements a one query algorithm in this probabilistic or non-deterministic fashion. But we also want the circuit to make very few queries. Like, as written, this circuit now makes m queries. So like, the original circuit that you're trying to implement, I mean, this fractional query algorithm, this makes only one query. Its cost is 1. But now I've given you a circuit that makes m queries. So it seems like, well, that wasn't useful at all. That was just a huge waste of time. But that's not really the case. And so now's where, like, maybe the real magic happens here, or maybe it happened in the previous step, I don't know. But something really nice happens, which is, this is the circuit I showed you on the previous slide. So think of this input state over here, which I'm going to blow up here. This is some fixed state. You know, it doesn't depend on the oracle or anything. It's just zero with this matrix R sub alpha acting on it. And R sub alpha, let me go back to where I defined R sub alpha. It's some matrix like this. And well, these expressions are hard to parse, so I'll tell you what happens. Is R sub alpha is actually a really tiny rotation. And it takes ket 0 to something that's essentially ket 0 and a very little bit of ket 1. So if you think of this tensor product state, it's a tensor product, an m-fold tensor product of a state that's essentially ket 0 and a little bit of non-ket 0 things. So if you write it down, there's a large weight on the first term, which is like the all-zero state. Then there is a little bit of weight on the states that have only one 1 inside them. Then there's even less weight on the states that have, you know, two 1s and so on. So the weight decreases with the Hamming weight of the string. So what you can do is, this is a state that has superposition, like that has weight on every single bit string. But the weight goes down as the number of 1s increases. So what you can do is just kill that part of the state. So the state that has very high overlap with the high Hamming weight states, you can just kill that part, just truncate it. And because the distribution is very strongly peaked around 0, this truncation is just going to affect your circuit by an epsilon. And so the question is, how far in Hamming weight do you need to go to be affected by epsilon? And that's only this much. And this comes out of doing a Chernoff bound calculation. So that's this question of, you know, I give you m coins that are very strongly biased towards 0. So the probability of getting a 1 is like 1 over m. The probability of getting a 0 is 1 minus 1 over m. And I toss all of these m coins. And then what's the most likely event? It's that you probably get all zeros. But in fact, I don't want to just find out the most likely event. I want to cover all the events that have probability 1 minus epsilon. So you just need to go to maybe, you know, a couple of heads appearing, or a couple of zeros, because it's so unlikely that you get 1 that if you just account for the possibility of there just being a couple of 1s, you've basically covered all possibilities. And the possibilities that you've neglected are only an epsilon fraction. So what we do in this circuit is just replace this state with the truncated state. And this truncated state has the property that it's epsilon closed, but it has very few 1s. Why does this help us that it has very few 1s? The 1s decide when the queries happen. So these are controlled query gates, and the queries only happen when there is a 1. So if most of the times, if no queries are happening, then you don't really need to be making that many queries. So for example, if you know that this state over here has at most this number of 1s, then really, there's only this number of queries happening in the circuit. Like it looks like there's more queries, but there's a way to rearrange the circuit so that you only make this number of queries, because in any branch of the superposition, there's only this number of 1s. So that's...
Aren't you still doing MUs?
Right. So MUs, so the U's are free.
Why are they free?
So, I mean, so we only charge the number of queries made to the oracle. So in this model.
Okay.
Right? So I mean...
Fine, but I'm just saying the point is you had to replicate the U you would have done with one query to be now MUs. You don't care if I only have to do two queries, I still have to do MUs now instead of one U.
Right. Yeah,
MU
well,
is where the actual system is running. The query is just telling you the parameter that goes at this point. You still have to use it. So the depth of the circuit got massively bigger.
Well, actually, yeah, that's not necessarily true. Like, okay. what you need to do here now is, well, I need to rearrange the circuit so that it actually only makes this number of queries. Like, as drawn, it still makes m queries. And in that new circuit, what will happen is there'll be a bunch of, I guess.
Well, I use different u's. A u that does m minus 3, which is the 0 case, and then 3 of them that are between the queries. I get
that. There'll be new u's, yeah.
I haven't seen a reason why that m is not a lot more complex or more depth than these u's at the mth level of them.
Right. I mean, if your u's are complicated to do, then I mean, this isn't going to help you. I mean,
I just needed to hear that. And I'm okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, so in these query models, the assumption is that the query is the main cost, and so we're trying to reduce the dependence on that.
Okay.
Yeah. So I mean, all non-query operations are free, even anything you feel like.
Okay.
So this.
I think we need to be more cautious here. I mean, even if the cost of U is negligible,
right?
What you are claiming is you end up doing an equivalent of O of one queries.
Right.
So the that means that the entire thing, right, doesn't depend on M. The symptomatically does not depend on M. So it has a cost that is constant in M.
Yes.
But if M is very large, if like M tends to infinity,
right,
then given a tiny cost associated to the U,
mm-hmm,
will add up, and will add a term that does have a dependency on M. And at a certain point, it will outgrow. When M tends to infinity, by nature of infinity, the cost of doing all those U's will outgrow the cost of...
Well, plus as the M's grow, you have to do more of the fractional Q's to get the Hamming way correct.
Right.
So you also have to do more queries also.
So it's not a clean asymptotic setup. You can claim that it's practically useful, but in a strict asymptotic sense, you kind of ruined it.
No, I guess, I mean, maybe we need to come back to the definition of what's the standard query complexity model. So in the standard query complexity model, you're allowed to call the query get Q some number of times. That's going to be the cost measure. But you're allowed to do arbitrary unitaries otherwise, and that are not charged for. Like, you can even solve undecidable problems. You can solve exponentially hard problems. The standard query complexity model allows you to do input-independent unitaries, whichever ones you like, as many as you want.
We agree.
Right.
We're talking more about if I was asking to put this on a machine.
Right.
So, there are practical reasons why you can't ignore the other items.
Right. So when I get to applying this to Hamiltonian simulation, I will need to care about this because I'm going to give you a bound on the total number of gates needed, and I'm going to show you that's also polynomial. So when I apply this to the specific case of Hamiltonian, everything's efficient. But in general, there's not much I can say because in the query complexity model, you're just allowed to use gates that are just crazy to implement. So, I mean, you could, like, U0 itself could be solving an undecidable problem, and then, that, you know, there's nothing you can do in any model to make that efficient.
Also, I have an issue here with whether alpha should be really seen as depending on M. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, what do you mean?
So right now, if I look at this literally,
right,
alpha is some magical small n.
So alpha is
you do not have to change as m is growing.
Oh yeah, no.
Alpha is 1 over n. So I haven't defined it here, but So alpha is the exponent of q. So when I define the gadget, it's here. So this little gadget, it does q to the alpha for you. So in our example, we wanted to q to the 1 over m. So alpha is 1 over m for the next two slides. So here, so this alpha is 1 over m. It's exactly 1 over m.
So we know that in practice, the cost of doing small n increases as the n will decreases. I mean, even with Nathan's magic.
You mean for actually implementing
the
rotations?
Yeah, implementing the Rs. Right?
Yeah.
But his comment is there's very few of them because you only have to do a few queries, so there aren't that many of them you actually do, no matter how big n is.
No, I mean, I guess what I'm saying is in this model we don't charge for this, but when I actually do Hamiltonian simulation, I will charge for it, and it won't be too bad. Like, it'll be fine. It'll scale.
Yeah.
There will be some dependence on M when we do Hamiltonian simulation because of exactly
for
this thing.
I would write alpha depending on M right there.
Right.
There is no.
It was on a previous
slide.
Right. Okay. Yeah, that's a good point. Maybe I'll put alpha equals 1 over m on the side.
It's good. Of the circuit.
Let him get to the point where he actually costs it,
yeah,
and then we'll
yeah.
There's more simplifications ahead.
Yeah.
Right. So you're concerned with the query cost, or
is it an amortized cost that you said you run over all these binary strings, but they're heavily concentrated at the low weights?
So
right.
you
use that to kind of say how many of these queries actually executed.
Right.
Don't we have to accommodate for the worst case?
Oh, right. Yeah. So this is not a proof. Like what? Like this is a circuit that still makes m queries because how do you count the number of queries? You look at the circuit, see how many q gates there are. So from this circuit, I would have to write down for you another circuit that only has this number of q gates in it. Like the full circuit, when you look at it drawn on a piece of paper, will only have a constant or whatever this number of q gates on it. And I'm just saying that can be done morally because they aren't really happening in superposition, but I need to show you that, which I'm not going to, because that's kind of technical. So yeah, but morally, I'm trying to convince you that, you know, in superposition, if every branch of the superposition only makes 5 queries, even though the gate has 100 queries, then somehow there should have been a way to write this circuit down so that it only made 5 queries. So I guess that's what I'm saying. Yeah, okay, so that's the last piece. Like, that was to show you how this is done. So that completes this chain of reasoning over here. And okay, so okay, yeah, I'll probably just take 5 or 10 more minutes and wrap this up. Yeah, okay, are there any questions about this chain here? Like, so I wanted to prove that, I reduced it to this, which I reduced to this, then I proved this, and then by the sequence of reductions, I've proved what I wanted to prove. Does that kind of make sense? Okay, yeah, so now I'm, okay, so this reduction is from here to here is also kind of technical, so I'm trying to convince you why Hamiltonian simulation is at all related to fractional query simulation, because at first glance, they have absolutely nothing to do with each other. One is a result about some query thing, some exotic query model. The other is about Hamiltonians. So, yeah. So what is this reduction? So take a very simple case of you have two Hamiltonians, H1 plus H2. H is the sum of these two Hamiltonians. And let's define Q1 to be e to the minus I H1 and Q2 to be e to the minus I H2. And you want to do this, you want to simulate the Hamiltonian H for time t. So that means you want to do this gate. This unitary, and so we know that approximately, you know, by this by the Lee-Trotter product formula, that this matrix is approximately you do the first one for time 1 over m, you do the second one for time 1 over m, and then you do this whole thing m times, and this is, well, approximately true. The error depends on m. So this guy I've defined as q1, and this guy is defined as q2. So this gate is essentially q1 to the t over m times q2 to the t over m done m times.
Isn't that n queries to Q1 and Q2?
No. You mean here?
Yeah.
No. So yeah. So I mean, I guess. Well, it depends on what you mean by queries. But like, if you think of Q1 and Q2 in this fractional query model, where you only charge for the total sum of the exponents.
Oh.
This is t over m, and it's happening m times. So it's really only happening t times in this, you know, this magical model where you only charge for these things. But as I previously convinced you, even though this model sounds crazy, you can actually convert it to the standard model. So, right, so if you go through this conversion, it turns out that this actually works, but you need to decompose the Hamiltonian into a sum of Hamiltonians, each of which look like query oracles. They look like the kinds of things that the previous model assumed. And so how do you get that, or what does that mean? Actually, let me go back to the slide where I described that. So, this fractional query gadget, the only assumption it made on Q is that Q was a unitary that's squared to 1, which is a property shared by this unitary. Of course, when you square it, you get 1 because minus 1 squares to 1. So you need to come up with a sum of Hamiltonians such that e to the minus I H1 squares to 1, which means that its eigenvalues are only plus minus 1. So if the unitary's eigenvalues are plus minus 1, the Hamiltonian's eigenvalues are 0 or pi. So you need to decompose your Hamiltonian into a sum of Hamiltonians, all of which only have two eigenvalues, 0 and pi. So that's the new challenge. Like, I give you an arbitrary sparse Hamiltonian. You need to break it up into sum of Hamiltonians, each of which have two distinct eigenvalues, and they need to be exactly 0 and pi. And well, now that sounds like just a crazy problem. Like, why? Like, now how can I solve that? Or why would that be something that's easy? It turns out that this is actually kind of easy. People had done things similar to this before, and a lot of the previous Hamiltonian simulation techniques have studied this kind of problem. So the way you do this, you break it into two steps. First, you decompose H into a bunch of one sparse Hamiltonians. And what one sparse means is in every row or column, there's only one non-zero entry. And almost every Hamiltonian simulation technique till now has had this as the first step. You always decompose it into sum of one sparse Hamiltonians. And this can be done, and there's a whole bunch of ways of doing it. And we give a new way of doing it in our paper, which is better in some respects. But anyway, that's doable. And then, given a one sparse Hamiltonian, you can decompose it into Hamiltonians that have only two different eigenvalues. So that's essentially this step. So you take this Hamiltonian, break it up into a bunch of Hamiltonians, each of which are something that the fractional query model understands and knows how to deal with. And then you use that whole reduction and then see what you get at the end. So you have to specifically do it for Hamiltonian simulation. Like, it's not easy to see if you just plug it in what happens. So we go through and do this and try to compute what's finally going to happen.
So if I have n terms to start with,
right?
How many do I wind up with at the bottom?
Here?
Yeah.
So if you have n terms in the sum? Wait, sorry, what do you mean? Like, the Hamiltonian is already decomposing?
Sum of h of n Hamiltonians. And now I'm going to go and break each one of those apart. Each one is going to explode by how much?
Okay, so that depends on what the property of the individual. Like, so what do your terms look like? Are they d-sparse or are they?
No.
I'm
doing quantum chemistry. So
they're
going to span the entire, some of them will be very tiny, some of them will span the entire set of qubits.
Right. So
they're one sparse in this language, and in particular poly operators.
Right.
They
I
are
mean,
one sparse?
So like your individual Hamiltonians are like products of poly operators, right? They're like sigma z times sigma x, whatever, something of that kind. So actually, if you have these poly operators as in quantum chemistry, you don't really need to do this. I mean, the only thing we wanted from your Hamiltonian was it has two different eigenvalues. Poly operators already have that, so you don't need to go through this decomposition. So in your application to quantum chemistry, you forget about this.
Good.
You can directly jump to the end because you already have just two eigenvalues.
Okay, so I don't explode my number of terms.
No. Right. Yeah. We're trying to deal with the general case where they're sparse, so we need to worry about this. But that's nice. So in specific cases where you already have a decomposition into a nice form, you can avoid this stuff. So that's essentially what links these two problems together. I mean, I've only sketched it because the details are gory, I guess. So this is what I'd explained. So I convinced you that this thing makes sense. And on the previous slide, I showed you the reduction. So. Now, the claim is that this makes sense based on all of this that I tried to convince you in the last hour. And there's also a lower bound, but maybe I'll skip that. That's not as interesting. I mean, people who work in query complexity all the time might be interested in seeing exactly how the lower bound goes, but maybe I can tell you later or tell you if there's time. Instead, I'd just like to highlight some other results that are in this paper, go back to give you a big picture perspective. So the previous Hamiltonian simulation algorithms had this log star n dependence on this Hamiltonian on n. And we show how to get rid of this. And it's not specific to our algorithm. We show how to get rid of this from all algorithms. So there's just, there was a reason this log star n kept coming up. And we just tackled the thing directly and show you that, well, you never needed it in the first place. It's not a big deal. Log star n is at most 6 for all these values of n. But theoretically, it's very unsatisfying that there was this annoying function of n there. It also made the papers really long, because every time you'd explain this log star n bit, that takes like 3 pages, because the algorithm that gives you log star n running time, I mean, it has to be complicated. How would you get a function like log star n unless you had a complicated algorithm to start with? So that's nice. And our algorithm is also gate efficient. Yeah, so this gets to the point of how do you actually do this. So by gate efficient, I guess we mean that the total number of non-query gates, as in the total number of 1 or 2 qubit gates that we use in addition to the query gates, this is pretty. It's pretty comparable to the query complexity. Like it's a log factor over the query complexity. And our algorithm also works for time-dependent Hamiltonians. And there's some dependence on the first derivative of the Hamiltonian, et cetera, if you care about time-dependent Hamiltonians. We have some improvements. There's a d squared term in our running time, but if the Hamiltonian is local, then it's actually only d. There's some savings if you know a specific form for the Hamiltonian, or if you know like an explicit decomposition to polys, like in the quantum chemistry example, then there's a speed up that you can get. And as I explained, the error's optimal for both problems, meaning both for Hamiltonian simulation and for the fractional query model. If you think of them separately, we show two different lower bounds showing you that you need this dependence on error. So it's not possible to improve that. So what's open? So what's open is like, our algorithm, say for the fractional query model or for the other model, it goes like this. We know a lower bound of this expression. So the epsilon dependence by itself is tight. We know that you need linear number of queries. This was shown before. But like that doesn't mean it has to go like this. I mean, in particular, this one goes like t log t-ish in t. So there's definitely possibility of improving that. But also, it doesn't need to go like this particular function. Like it could go like t plus log 1 over epsilon, log 1. I mean, there's possibilities for improving the upper or lower bound, I guess is what I'm saying. Not by too much, they're kind of close, but there's some way to improve it. And then of course there's applications, like what can we do in instances that people care about, for example, quantum chemistry. There's the third question that's very specific to Hamiltonian simulation, people who work on this, that our dependence on the degree is quadratic, but We think it should be linear. We don't know how to do that. And it's important for things that have high degree. So that's something that's also open. OK, yeah, I think that's the end of what I wanted to say. Any questions? Or? Nathan?
Sure. So for number three, do you see any way around this problem other than devising a graph coloring algorithm that's as efficient as Vising's algorithm?
No. I think what's going to have to be done is someone has to come up with a good parallel graph coloring algorithm that uses big O of D colors to color a degree D bipartite graph or whatever. Like,
well,
isn't
necessarily
yeah. Well, that only makes your life easier.
Sure.
Yeah. But sure, you could, I guess, assume it's not bipartite. But, the only way I know how to attack the problem looks like it's a very hard problem in distributed algorithms. Any other questions about this, sir?